And it's good to see you here. Sounds like a cloud coming up outside, but we will be completely dry in here, and we're thankful for that, as well as your attendance with us. We're also glad to have those who are joining us by live stream. It's good to have each of you here, and we know we have guests worshiping with us today, and we're thankful for that as well. If you are a guest, we hope you'll take the little tear off that's on your bulletin, complete the one side that says welcome, and place that in the offering plate later on in the service, and that way we'll have a record of your attendance. But it is good to see each of you here. By way of announcement, several things taking place today. Of course, just right after the lunch, after church, there will be a lunch for the Babb family. And those, we appreciate those who have brought food and helped with that. And the service, Miss Carolyn's service, will be today here at 3 with visitation from 1:30 to 3. Then, of course, choir rehearsal at 5, worship at 6, and then we have a fellowship after church tonight that you're invited to as well. So keep these things in mind. This week coming up, Wednesday night, we'll be back on our regular schedule. The kids will be back in school, so take note of that. Next Sunday is another busy Sunday. Our adult choir will be presenting their Easter music, Because He Lives, Amen. Then following that, we'll have our Easter egg hunt. It's everyone's invited to attend. We have a hot dog lunch. The Easter Bunny will be here for pictures. And then preschoolers through grade 6 will hunt eggs. And then sometime during that time, our Bible drillers will jump in the van and head to Bastrop for the district drills at 2:30. We will not have services next Sunday night. And then just a reminder that Easter Sunday, we'll have one service in the morning at 9:30, and I encourage you to be inviting family and friends to that as well. You see the prayer request we have listed, those who are sick at home or in the hospital, and our missionaries who are celebrating birthdays today. And we do want to continue to remember the family of Miss Carolyn Babb and others in our church and in our community who have lost loved ones in recent days. But let's just begin our service in an attitude of prayer.
Your heart is kind for all. 1,000 reasons for my heart to find. Let the Lord of my soul worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul worship Your holy name. And on that day, draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Sing with me, please. Let's worship His holy name. Revive us again, verses 2 and 3. We praise Thee, O God, for the Son.
Our dear Heavenly Father, we are grateful this morning for the privilege we have to gather and worship You. It's a day that You've made, and we're going to rejoice and be glad in it because You are with us. You promised never to leave us or forsake us. You promised that no matter what comes our way, You're going to walk with us through it, leading the way. And we didn't have to fear, even as the psalmist said, I'll fear no evil because You're with me. Your rod and Your staff are comforting me. Lord, thank You for the watch care that You give us each day. And may we give of our best to You each and every day as well. Thank You for these who are here. And I know that You know their hearts this morning. And You know the concerns they have, maybe for personal matters as well as for others. But as You hear our prayers, answer them in a way that will bring the greatest glory to Yourself. And Lord, we'll just thank You for the privilege of worship. The opportunity to say thank You, as well as an opportunity to listen to Your voice and respond as You lead us with our lives. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Be seated. Power in the blood.
Thank you, Mike. Mike's filling in for us this morning as Robbie's on his way back from Thibodaux, Louisiana. Had a band event down there went into the night last night. So pray for him as he travels. He'll be with us this afternoon for the funeral as well as tonight's services. But I'm glad that you're here. Thank you, Mike, for filling in. And we have others that are doing different things this morning, but I'm glad you're here as we worship the Lord together. So we want to welcome you who are our guests. And again, as Beth said, if you don't mind filling out the flap that's on the bulletin and drop that in the offering plate when it comes by, it'll be our way of having a record of your attendance with us today because we're thankful you've come. And if you're a sixth grader and under, during the welcome time, come join us here at the platform if you don't mind. But let's stand and greet each other and get to know someone new during the time of greeting as well.
Thank you.
Well, good morning. It's good to see y'all. Do y'all think it's going to rain? Can y'all hear the thunder? I hope not. There is. Does that mean we're supposed to go outside and watch for a tornado if it's a tornado watch? You don't think so? That just reminded me of my favorite song. One of my favorite songs we used to sing, and the verse went, I've seen it in the lightning, heard it in the thunder, and felt it in the rain. And I started it too low. My God is near me all the time. My God is near me all the time. I should have let Brother Smith sing it. But that was a song we used to sing. It was a pretty song, and it talks about the weather. But, you know, we've been the last several Sundays in our church talking about our relationship with God and our testimonies. And I talked to y'all about how a testimony is your story. Your story about different things. We can testify about different things. But in this setting, we're talking about our testimony as in our relationship with Jesus in the time that we asked Jesus to come into our heart. And if you were here and remember one Sunday, Brother Smith passed out these sheets of paper, and it kind of had an outline thing on it for us to fill in. And the first question is, what was my life like before I accepted Christ? Then what caused me to know that I needed God's forgiveness? What I did to actually receive Christ as my Savior, and then what my life has been since being saved. And he said he wanted us to do a Lakeshore Book of Life with the testimonies in our church members, and this is the beginning of it. Everybody who's done their testimony and turned it in, see, we've got it in a little slip sheet here, and it's been interesting reading about how God has worked in the lives of different people. No two people's testimonies alike. Nobody's is the exact same age or place or date or year or the same circumstances, but it shows how God has worked in the lives of people. And you know, that's something really neat that we can know, especially if we know we have Christians around us. And we learn in the Bible about how Timothy, he had a very faithful grandmother and mother who passed their faith on to him. So we know that Timothy learned from them, and he learned from other Christians. And there's a verse in the Bible, Psalms 107:2, and it says, let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story. The redeemed of the Lord is those who are saved, those who are Christians, who have given their heart and life, who Jesus has come and claimed us back. He's redeemed us back for the Heavenly Father. And you know, the Bible is full of stories of the redeemed. And as we come to Sunday school, and hopefully at home as you do your devotionals, you're learning things from people who are Christians, who have a story to tell you. And then as we grow and learn, we can tell more things, and that's important even for you at your age. You have a story to tell about what your relationship is with Christ, whether he's still working on you right now, whether you've already accepted him. He's doing something in your life, and you can share that with other people. And that's why I think this is so neat that we can have, that we can see, actually read what someone's testimony is, and it also helps us be reminded of ours. But know that there are people around you, hopefully your parents and grandparents and aunts and uncles and neighbors and your teachers and friends at church, and I pray your school teachers or Christians, that they have a story they can share with you. You might want to ask them sometime to tell you about the time they asked Jesus into their heart. And that would be very interesting to hear. I can remember when I heard about my parents. My mother was a little girl. She was 9 years old. And she said she realized one day that she couldn't do anything they were talking about God and sins and forgiveness on her own. And she knew she needed Jesus in her heart. My daddy was in his 20s. When he made the decision. So see, their stories were a lot different, but it was the same ending. They both were Christians. And so do that. Think about what your story is and ask those around you to tell you their story. It'll give them the opportunity to share, and it'll even help you grow in your walk with Christ. Let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story. Let's pray. God, we do thank you for this day, Lord, the blessings you've given us. And God, we thank you for those who have shared their story with each of us. Lord, those from years gone by or even those still living today, God, we know we each have a story that we can share about you. And God, we realize that that's our purpose in life, is to tell others about you. And God, I pray as a church family, we would be the kind of church family that we need to be to these children, that they see in the things that we do and we say, and just every part of our lives will help them to grow to be better Christians and closer to you. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Redeemed, how I love proclaiming. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, redeemed through his infinite mercy, this child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of child, and forever I am. Bill, I couldn't help but we'll do that song right after
okay.
That.
I thought okay. We messed up in the book.
No. We're going to sing At the Cross now.
As we come to this time of offering, we're certainly thankful for God's blessings in our life, and we want to just pray a prayer of thanksgiving. And Charles, would you lead us in this prayer, please, sir?
Dear Lord, thank you for this day you've given us today. Thank you for the blessings of life that you send to us and help us be examples that you'd want us to be. Thank you for the Easter season and the anticipation in the next few weeks as we celebrate you dying on the cross and coming back to life again. Bless this offering to the good of the church. Be with the needs of the church. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. And how great He is. We're grateful that we can serve such a great and loving God. As Beth shared earlier, we began to turn our attention toward Easter now. And today we're celebrating the Lord's Supper. You see, you have the cross and then Easter. And those of you who are part of our Sunday school, and I hope that if you're not, you will be. You'll get involved in one of our classes. But we're in the last week of the life of our Lord in our studies in Sunday school right now. What a magnificent Savior we serve. How wonderful He was and how He approached people and how He dealt with them, even those who needed the word of judgment shared with them. He had a way of doing it that just put the finger right on your heart and spoke to you and had a way of getting your attention. But this morning we celebrate the Lord's Supper, which was the Passover meal for those in that day. You see, once a year, that annual festival you attended if you were a Jew. There were three festivals that were annual that they had to attend, and the Passover was one of those. But this was not just the Passover experience. This was also the first Lord's Supper. You see, He took that supper that night with the disciples and gave it new and even greater meaning for them and told us to do it until He came back again. Next Sunday, our choir will be presenting the message of Easter through song. It's actually that last week and the cross and then Easter. It's all in that musical. I hope you'll be here for that next Sunday morning. And then Easter Sunday, as we will celebrate. We used to have two services on Easter because our building wouldn't hold everybody. We enlarged it, and now we can seat everybody in one service. But people like the earlier service and the later one, too. So we've gone to an early morning, a 9:30 service for Easter. So keep that in mind, the change of schedule two Sundays from now, as we'll be celebrating Easter itself. Jesus came, and we celebrate Christmas, but you know, all through His life, He continued to tell them, but this is the reason I've come. And He would point to His death, burial, and resurrection. But on that particular night that Jesus was preparing to celebrate with the disciples, let me read from Luke's gospel what He shared with them. Then the day of unleavened bread came when the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and prepare the Passover meal for us so we can eat it." "Where do you want us to prepare it?" they asked Him. "Listen," He said to them, "when you've entered the city, a man carrying a water jug will meet you. Follow him into the house he enters. Tell the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks you, where is the guest room where I can eat the Passover with my disciples?' Then he will show you a large, furnished room upstairs. Make the preparations there." So they went and found it just as He had told them, and they prepared the Passover. When the hour came, He reclined at the table and the apostles with Him. And then He said to them, "I have fervently desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Then He took a cup, and having given thanks, He said, "Take this and share it among yourselves. For I tell you, from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And He took bread, gave thanks, broke it, gave it to them, and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, He also took the cup after supper and said, "This cup is the new covenant established by my blood. It is shed for you. But look, the hand of the one betraying me is at the table with me. For the Son of Man will go away as it has been determined. But woe to that man by whom he is betrayed." Jesus knew Judas was going to betray Him. And He's sharing that with the others so that they are also made aware that somebody is going to. In fact, the very next verse says that they began to argue among themselves which one of them it would be who was going to do this thing. For none of them believed it could be them. But one did. And even Peter, as bold as he was, said, Lord, I'll die before I allow anything to happen to you. And yet, Jesus said, the spirit's willing, but the flesh is weak. This night, before the rooster crows in the morning, you're going to deny me three times. Peter just could not believe that would happen, but it did. But Jesus took an annual festival, an annual feast time, that you normally had with your family or close family friends with you. Because that very first Passover, if they did not have a large enough family to eat the Passover lamb that had been killed and cooked, if they could not eat that themselves, they were told to invite others into their house because everything was to be eaten that night because Pharaoh's going to let them go and everything needs to be taken care of. So there were more than just family members sometimes in these houses where the Passover meal would take place. As time went on, it was mostly just their family. But Jesus is with his family, so to speak. The disciples who have followed him for these 3.5 years are with him, and he's wanting to celebrate it with them in order to share with them some things that would make this moment a new and greater moment for them. It would remind them of the past when the death angel had passed over their homes of in the ancestors in Egypt and had allowed them to gain freedom, and of course their disobedience caused them to have to wander in the wilderness for 40 years before getting back to that point where they could enter the promised land. He had much better waiting for them, and their obedience or disobedience kept them from it. But obedience will always allow us to those things that God has in store for us. But those elements of the meal and the cups of wine that they would be drinking during the course of that meal would be symbolizing that which had happened, but also that which was to come. And Jesus is saying to them in this moment, this time, you're going to see some things about to take place that's always been predicted through this meal, but it's now at hand. When he said, I'm not going to eat this or drink this until, he's meaning now is the time, and I'm going to be crucified, I'm going to rise from the grave, I'm going back to heaven, and there I'll be celebrating with you in the future. But this is going to be the last time. In other words, there's not going to be another year go by for us to come back to this particular festival of the Passover and do this again with my being present with you. And from now on, you're going to do this in remembrance of me, not just in celebration of what happened in the past, but now remembering me for what I'm doing for you and for all others. And so he took that meal and he gave it new and greater meaning. The fact that now this unleavened bread would be representing his body. And of course, you know, the Passover, it was a time when they made sure there was no leavening in their houses. They cleaned the house out. They searched everywhere to make sure there was no leavening. This is where spring cleaning came from. It was in the springtime, the Passover meal, and they always went through everything in their house to make sure there was no leavening, because leaven represented evil, sin, and they were to make sure none of that was in their house. Jesus is the sinless one. The unleavened bread represents the sinless Christ that was broken for us. His body was beaten to the point that the Bible says that he was beyond recognition as he hung on that cross. And yet he took those stripes for us. And that vine, that juice that they would drink, that fruit of the vine, as the Bible says, represented his blood that would be spilled. The blood of Jesus was given for us. There's life in the blood. In fact, you cut off the blood supply to any part of your body, and that part of the body dies. You lose the blood from your life, from your body, and your whole body dies. He gave his life through the shedding of his blood. It is the blood of Jesus that cleanses us of all righteousness. It was the blood of those lambs through the years that had been slain to ask for the forgiveness of the sins of the people, but it was never enough. But Jesus, the Bible says, is the perfect Lamb of God, who was actually slain before the beginning of time. God knew that we would sin. God knew there would be a need for redemption, and he had the plan already laid out. And though the plan was already there, it was never going to be an easy one. Our Lord, as he prayed in that Garden of Gethsemane, following this time with the disciples in the upper room, and they would go out to the Garden of Gethsemane, and he would leave one group of disciples, take the three that were closest to him off a little further, and he asked them to pray with him while he went on a little further and prayed. Agony of prayer was so great that the blood vessels of his body burst, and the sweat drops included, it was like blood falling. It was the blood. Talking about intense praying. You talk about an agonizing time in his life. I've never prayed like that, and you haven't either. We might have had some intense moments of prayer, but nothing like this. And it was all because of what he knew was ahead. And he asked the Father, if there's any other way that this can be accomplished, let this cup pass from me. Lord, if there's any other way that we can provide the salvation of these people except this. You see, the plan had been there, but it was not easy to go to a cross. It was not easy to go through the whippings that he got, the lashings that he got with the whips. He knew what was ahead. And he was praying that somehow it could be accomplished in another way. But he always, all three times that he prayed, he ended the prayer by saying, "Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done." The cost for our salvation may be free for us, but it cost heaven, the Son of God, to give himself in my place and yours. And as we come to the celebration of the Lord's Supper, to me, it is a message in itself. For I want us to remember what Jesus did for us. And we're in these days leading up to his death on the cross and then the glorious resurrection day. May we be reminded of the cost of our salvation. And may it call from us the very best that we have to give to him. And if you're here this morning and you've never accepted Christ as your personal Savior, I pray that the reminder of what Jesus did that you could be saved will be preeminent in your minds today. And that it will bring from you a desire to want to trust him and to follow him. And that you would even make such a commitment this morning, because it's the greatest decision you'll ever make. It's the most important decision you'll make in all of your life, because it determines not only the help that you'll get from God here in this life, but it will determine your eternal destiny as well. It's that important a decision. And so I want us to bow together in just a time of prayer and meditation. For the Bible says we should never enter this moment without examining our hearts before God. And if you're a child of God, you need to examine your heart as to how is your walk with him right now. Are you following him closely? Are you obedient to him? Is there sin in your life that needs to be forgiven? And it's just between you and the Lord right now. And you know that he knows everything about you. The Bible says even the intent of your heart. And all you have to do is just confess that sin to him. If you're here this morning, you're not a Christian, it's an opportunity for you to say, "Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I've never trusted you, but I want you to forgive me of my sins. Come into my life and to save me." And if you'll ask sincerely, he says he'll hear and he'll answer. You see, the Bible also says if we don't examine our hearts, if we don't get that sin of our life forgiven from him, and we partake of this Lord's Supper, we are putting him on that cross again. It's as if it doesn't mean anything. he means when he says if you partake of it in an unworthy manner, that means that's what he's talking about, in a manner that's not worthy of the occasion, which is that I have not examined my heart and received that cleansing from God that I need. In other words, it's not to be taken lightly. It's a serious matter. And here at Lakeshore, we also invite you, if you're a guest of ours this morning, if you're a child of God and would like to participate, we invite you to participate with us, because we're a part of the family of faith, and that's what's the most important thing. Yes, it is a church family, but it's also the larger family of faith. So if you would like to participate, feel free to do so, as we'll be passing these elements in just a few moments. And our Heavenly Father, we do pray that this morning, that as we've examined our hearts before you, that we've dealt personally with those matters that we know that you know, because we don't hide anything from you. You know everything. And so, Lord, I trust that we have dealt with those things in a way that will truly cleanse our lives, will give us that sense of joy that we are like beginning anew with you, as we're reminded of the price that you paid for us to be forgiven. And you said now that if we'll just ask, you will forgive, if we ask believing. And so, Lord, as you've heard from each of us, I just pray now that as we come to this celebration of the Lord's Supper, that it will be done in a way that will be worthy of that which you did for us. In the seriousness of our hearts, remembering the price that you paid, thanking you for doing that we could not do for ourselves. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. As our deacons come to help share this with you, the Bible says that on that night he took the bread and he broke it and he gave it to them and he said, "Eat this and do it in remembrance of me." And so as we pass this to you this morning, it is that you'll hold it and then we'll partake of it together. While you're getting this, use it as a time of meditation as you receive it and you continue to pray and remember what Jesus has done for you. I would also remind you that another symbolic thing of the manner in which we do it, I think is so beautiful, is that we serve one another. I give it to the deacons, they give it to you, and you give it to one another. We're all equal before the cross. We all stand together. We are all kneeling before the cross, really, falling on our faces in thanksgiving for what he's done. But as children of God, we're equal before him, as nobody's better than another. And our serving one another is indicative of that. scriptures remind us that this is the bread which came down out of heaven, not like your fathers ate and died, but he that eateth this bread shall live forever. And may we eat of it together, thanking him for giving of himself for us. The Bible says that on that same night he took the cup then, and having blessed it, he gave it to them to drink as well, reminding them that he would share it with them in the kingdom to come. And he was already looking forward to that other side, and one day we can join him there as well. And as our deacons come forward again, we want to pray together, thanking him for shedding his blood for our sins. And Richard, would you lead us in this prayer, please, sir?
Our Lord God, we thank you for this time we can come and celebrate this special event, remembering of you and what you did for us. Be with us now as we take this cup and this drink that represents the blood that washes away our sins, and so we can have that eternal life with you. Bless us. Be with us. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Scripture says that apart from the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. He also said if we will confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us of all sin. In thanksgiving for the fact that he had given it all for us, even the shedding of his blood, let's partake together. On that night, when they finished, they sang a hymn and then went out to the Garden of Gethsemane. We don't know what they sang. It would have been interesting to know. It must have been a men's choir. By now, Judas has already left the group. He's gone. He slipped out to go meet with those that he's going to bring to the Garden of Gethsemane. He knew what Jesus would do, where he would go, and he would bring them back there. And he would go to that garden spot to pray. He could have prayed in the upper room, couldn't he? But that garden was a special place where he would pray, where he had been on other occasions to pray. Maybe you have your special place to pray. I hope you do. I hope you go there often. And remember what Jesus did for us, even as you go there to pray. I want us just to share together in a hymn of invitation. Let's stand together as we sing. If there was a decision you made earlier that needs to be made public, we invite you to come, either trusting Jesus as your Savior, rededicating your life, whatever it might be. Would you let him have his way right now as we sing together?
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray, find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain.
Let's sing that second verse together.
Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change.
And certainly that power in his alone can give us strength for daily living as well. Depend on him, trust in him, lean on him for that strength that he said, I'll be with you always, never to leave you nor forsake you. We're grateful for that. Thank you for being here this morning. I pray that as we go from this place of worship, we'll go in the assurance that our Lord loves us with an everlasting love. And if you haven't trusted him yet, there's still time. If you have questions, see us. We want to help you. We want to answer those questions for you, because the most important decision, as I said, is to know him as Savior and Lord of life. A couple of things before we have our closing prayer. If you don't mind helping us, everybody together can make a big difference. If you'll just help pick up the cups or anything where you are, since we're having the funeral this afternoon, and of course the family's going to be here in here visiting even before the public visitation starts at 1:30. You'll be a big help to us if you can just kind of straighten the books and pick up the bulletins and those kinds of things, and maybe even your little cups. We've got trash cans in the back that you can drop that in if you don't need to take it with you. But don't forget to pray for Keith and the family. Glad that Keith could be with us this morning, and family members that have joined us as well. Pray for them, each and every one of them, and others that will be coming in as well. Don't forget evening services at 6 o'clock today. Hope you'll be back as we'll continue. We're going behind the veil tonight to that Ark of the Covenant. We're going to talk about the Ark itself tonight in the tabernacle. Let's close with prayer, thanking the Lord we could be here and praying for one another in a very special way. Scotty Barnes, would you lead us, please, sir, in prayer?
Father, we come to you today, and we just thank you for giving us a story to tell. Without your shed blood, we'd be nowhere, and we thank you for that. We thank you for your gift of life for us in eternity. Lord, we do pray for the Babb family and for Keith and his friends that have come to celebrate the life of his wife. And thank you for this day, and we just pray that rain will hold off too, Lord, for us. In your name we pray. Amen.